We are forbidden, and you are watching BrutalBroadcast.com.
Yeah. All right.
In your face.
In your face. What's up, metalheads? This is Death Metal Dave, and you're watching BrutalBroadcast.com, and I have caught up with Forbidden on tour to support their newest album, Omega Wave. What's up, guys?
What's happening?
What's up?
What's up?
Get on your knees in our bus!
Yes.
Omega Dave.
Omega Dave.
Omega Slave. Your new name.
If we could introduce everybody on the bus and explain what you do for the younger kids.
I'm Russ Anderson and I sing.
I'm Matt Camacho and I pretend to play bass.
I'm Craig Lucicero and I sometimes play guitar on TV.
Steve Smythe, guitars.
Mark Hernandez, drums.
All right, cool, man. So how's this tour going so far?
It's kick ass.
It's kick ass to see you guys back around again.
Awesome to be out here again.
Yeah, it seems like everybody is up in front singing the songs, and the arms are up in the air between each song, and the metal sign is up. It's great, man.
Hell yeah. Cool. If we could we go back a little bit to the history of Forbidden and Forbidden Evil? Could we talk with
Sure, yeah. We'd be the guys to talk about that.
How did you guys come together as Forbidden Evil, I guess?
Well, I mean, Russ was found in an ad, actually, before they were called anything, and it was Rob Flynn and a bunch of other guys looking for a singer. And Russ was like the dude from LA that, you know, or actually he wasn't found in an ad. He found the ad, right? Right, Russ? You found the ad?
No, actually, that's wrong.
Yeah, I knew it. Oh, man.
This is when I was in like 10th grade, mind you, so you go ahead.
Was that the ad in the back of the Hustler magazine?
Yes. No, that was actually Playgirl.
No, that's correct. Rob Flynn called me out of an ad I put out when I moved here from LA. I'm toured out to the Bay Area. Yeah, I'm from Florida. Oh my God. Anyway, we started up Forbidden Evil, and it was just for fun, doing backyard parties at the time, and you know, doing Metallica covers and just, you know, King Diamond stuff and some other things. And, you know, kind of went from there to getting Craig.
Actually, the timeline's all wrong there. There was no parties, no nothing. These guys had played in a garage and then they didn't have a place to play. And then I said to Russ, I could play guitar better than that guy you got. So then I played him Balls of the Wall. And you're like, you know what, dude? You're pretty all right. And then we used my garage. Then we played our first parties. We never actually Forbidden Evil didn't exist until we were called War Witch, War Cry, Warhead. We had all these stupid fucking names that we were coming up with, and then but Jim Pittman had Forbidden Evil sitting in his like in the back of his mind for a long time. It was a song by War Cry. It was a song by a band called War Cry. It wasn't War Cry. But anyway, Forbidden Evil. Forbidden Evil was somebody else's, that got another guy's not here, his name, and he gave it to us, and we started a band after that. Once we got Bo Staff in the band, that was when we became really something to reckon with, you know, and he'd never played metal before he played with us, really.
Wow,
he was doing rock and roll shit. But with so much power and energy, we're like, that dude needs to be playing metal, and he wanted to do it too, so.
Right.
Oh, I also got something to share on that timeline too. It was like, the one thing that I was doing, I was sitting on the sideline, I kind of knew Craig from high school, and I would ride the bus with Rob, but the parties were legendary that Forbidden Evil was playing. I mean, 40 cop cars, you know, walls being torn down, and I was hearing about this across the bay, you know, like, and I'm all, ooh, how can I manipulate my way into this band, so. So I worked my way in slowly and pretty soon they couldn't get rid of me.
Oh, I remember you throwing the keggers through the window at one of those parties. You were in the band then.
I was there. But no, I knew Matt, because that's exactly right. And the parties were sick like that. Like, because here's the thing. We grew up in Fremont, California, right? It's like any of these other suburbs of Florida. But this is before metal and thrash was really big. Thrash metal especially. In Fremont, no one had heard Exodus, Slayer, Venom, nothing but me really and Rob and like one or two other guys. And when we started playing these songs live, it was like just mayhem ensued, man. People didn't know how to react when you're playing Violence Enforced by Exciter, or you know, we were playing Lesson in Violence by Exodus before the album even came out. We had that one down. Remember, it was before Bonded by Blood even came out. So people just went, the punks got into it and the jocks were freaking out because the punks were freaking out, and then just be fights and fucking fences were torn down and cops would show up. That was how we got the beginning of our reputation.
By what year was that?
85. This is all in 85, wow. Dude. I was still, like I said, I was a sophomore in high school. So my memory is clear on some things and selectively not so clear on others.
So you formed a band, you got it together, and then what was next? You recorded a demo? How did that come about?
Yeah, we recorded a demo, then we started playing the clubs and stuff with Exodus and Testament, or like Legacy at the time, and it just went from there, you know. So,
well, yeah, that's exactly right, and everything took off from that point. But we got our foot through the door. I mean, we were playing Ruthie's Inn before we had management, and that was one thing. But once we got Debbie Abono, when Debbie Abono stepped into our lives and helped us out, we got better gigs, better slots and shows, you know, the respect level went up, and then we had to take ourselves a little more seriously too, you know, just a little. And she was a huge part of the beginning of this band, and you know, she'd passed away this year, and we miss her very, very much, but she was a huge part of the beginning of Forbidden Evil. We were Forbidden Evil at that point.
And then you got signed with
Combat.
Yes. Okay.
In
1988. You got signed, yeah. And then you changed your name to Forbidden. Yeah.
Thought it'd be easier, you know, Forbidden.
More ambiguous.
It's more open-ended, a lot less, like, stupid stuff attached to it. We didn't care if anyone thought we were satanic or not. That was definitely not an issue.
It was before all the death metal bands and stuff like that. I mean, if you think about it, like, Forbidden Evil would be, once the 90s came in and all these death metal bands with the names you can barely read would have been really cool. But at that time, they were like, how can we make you guys more commercially successful? There was that talk. So there was...
That isn't why. This band never tried to be commercially successful at all.
Didn't work if we did.
You're all about not being like that. So, yeah, we just use that name because it just, you can add any, you can think of it different ways than just we're evil. And I don't really consider all these guys, I've known them for, especially these two, forever. And, you know, they're not a bunch of evil guys. They're a bunch of nice guys, really. They're
a bunch of guys hanging out, drinking beer, huh?
Really good musicians. And we just... have these guys now too, and they're probably better than we are.
So you paid tribute to the old name by naming the first album Forbidden Evil?
Right, yeah, exactly. Okay. Yeah,
that was exactly why we did it.
And you had successful tours after that?
Yes. Yeah, well.
You did the one video, it was...
Step by Step.
Ultimate Revenge. That was all done. The Ultimate Revenge is really the first show we ever played out of California. When we got signed to Combat, they're like, we got a great idea because we got you guys. You're the last band that's going to be on this thing. We're going to call it Ultimate Revenge 2. I'm like, ooh, I loved one. Who's on it? And then they're like, oh, it's Raven. We're like, huh? Death, yeah. Dark Angel, yeah. And Faith or Fear, huh? We're like, okay. You're flying us out, we're there, you know. So we didn't know what the hell we were doing. We were just out of our minds and just enjoyed every second of that thing, but it was insanity to us. We had never been out of the state really as a band, you know. That was the beginning of everything. And I still, to this day, every show, man, I remember you guys on Ultimate Revenge 2.
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, we were green.
We got out there.
I have it, actually.
Yeah, got out there.
I have that video, so...
So they have it on a thing called YouTube, and you can watch it anytime.
There you go. VHS, huh? That's what it is.
Yep, VHS.
No, you got beta, right?
No,
beta.
VHFs. That was close to beta at that time as well, actually.
Got Betamax.
That's how long ago it was.
There's kids out there listening right now. What is VHS? What are they talking about?
So how did the band progress after that? another album?
Really quickly, actually, and that's part of our the overall fucking downfall of it too. We just like it was really good at first. When we're jumping into the Twist and the Form thing, we were zipping and we had total chemistry. Once we got Tim Calvert in the band, we really escalated quickly, and it kind of left some of our fans at like Forbidden Evil like scratching their heads, like, wow, you guys really evolved fast. They didn't really know how to react to Twisted into Form at first, and then they ended up loving it. You know, it ended up being a lot more successful than Forbidden Evil even. But it was, I remember distinctly the first few times people listening go, wow, whoa, you know, what's this? But we did that, and you know, we thought we were on a roll. We did the tour with Death Angel, everything was going great. And then the industry flipped, like, you know, in a matter of months, completely did a 360. And in that period, we'd really even gone even more into more melodic, you know, influenced by stuff that Tim was really into, like the Queensryche stuff. And it was like, where's the old thrash? You know, people were like, where'd it go? And then nobody wanted thrash. All of a sudden, gone. Nobody wanted that kind of metal. Nobody wanted thrash. Nobody wanted nothing. And that's when Paul joined Slayer. So he got right on he went to the right place at the right time.
Right,
because that's the only one that survived. Besides, the big four were really the only ones that survived. That's why they are the big four.
Right,
because everyone else perished, except for Overkill, who was in that bus over there. You can't see, but those guys did a great job because they survived, man. And they never gave up. But we definitely went through our trials and tribulations all the way to two records later with Distortion and Green, where we put out cool records, but they were victims of shit going on, you know, just not quite clarity of thought in the whole songwriting process. And you know, you fast forward all the way to Omega Wave, and we got it down now. We understand what we were, what was good about what we did, what Forbidden should have been and stayed, all those things we lost track of. And that's partially because we had new blood that were students of the band that liked us in all those eras, but they knew what was wrong with us too, you know. It's a good combination now.
And how did these guys join into the band?
You might want to knee your way over here.
Yeah. probably work your way over here.
It's like Dorf on death metal, dude.
That's what I was saying, man. Dorf on death metal.
That's for you, you older kids.
Oh, how did I get it? Oh, it was by chance, man, actually. I was playing in a rock band, and actually... Glenn had a metal band he was playing with, and through friends, they just happened to have the talk because they were going to do the reunion, and Paul actually got the phone call, I think, at the meeting you guys were having. So they were looking for a drummer. And I think, it was actually just, I think the stars lined up, man. I went down there, I did it. And I don't know if I convinced them the first time, but, you know, I came back, I did the tour. And that's kind of the end of it.
Your pants came down in France.
I told him 3 days.
You were in.
You don't want it. But, you know, anyways, that's kind of how it happened. And it took a long time for me to even kind of like become official. And I still remember Craig, you know, I'd always bug him like, hey, you know, I'm here. We're doing this. He's like, you know what? By the time it happens, you're not going to care. And you know what? He was right. Because by the time they made the official statement, I was like, I don't care, you know, I'm already here.
He was already a part of the band.
Yeah,
for a long
you know, so it just, I think it was just my time, that's all I can say. You know, I've been working at it since I was their age too. I'm just a little bit younger. So, but that's all I can say. It was just my time. I'm just blessed to be where I am right now, be on this bus, living the dream, the illusion.
Living the illusion.
I always hear it's the illusion. Yeah.
Yes, it is.
So that's me in a nutshell.
For myself, it's probably a little bit different. I've got a little bit of history with these two guys over here, and actually through Glenn as well too. I did a little fill in for this guy at the Thrash of the Titans back in 2001.
Ironically,
very ironically,
that's a whole other story. Yeah.
So we ended up playing a couple of songs at that, and I think maybe that stuck in their minds a little bit, and. Got a call from Craig back in November 2008, November, December, somewhere around there, and basically I live out of the country now, and as soon as I got in, we hooked up. It was me, Craig, and Matt, and we just went down to like a local sushi spot somewhere down in the city and hung out and just talked.
It was Thai food,
that's what it was, yeah. And just kicked back, had a little bit of that, had some beers, and... talked some shit and figured some shit out, and then they wanted me to come and jam in January 2009, and so I did, and we played I think what became Adapter Die and Hypnosis.
Yeah, we had those pretty well put together, but then he added his stamp. But I just got to say, in just short snap, both these guys, you know, so you talk about new blood and what they bring to a band, but both these guys are two of the most talented dudes. We've all played together, but we played with some really, really great musicians in this band. You can go through the long line of guys who did, it's not all that long, it just seems like it, but, you know, you go from Rob Flynn to Glenn Alvalies to Tim Calvert to this guy. These guys are amazing. You know, they're all great players. You go, you know, from Paul Bostaff to Steve Jacobs to Gene Hoagland, who sat in for the first few shows, to Mark Hernandez. These guys are all amazing. So, you know, they really make us, Russ is kind of right, they make us look better. They're really, really good, and the chemistry's there, and it feels like a better band just because of the chemistry reason, and there's just less tension. It's no, you know, these guys are all great that we played with, but there's too much drama sometimes, and that's gone, you know, so we have a whole new thing we're dealing with here, and a whole new set of drama. I mean, it's going to be new stuff.
Fighting over beers.
Yeah, we'll get disgruntled over crap later. But now we're cool.
We fight over who gets to take a shit first. When we get
that's right. Who steals the key from under somebody else's nose?
Who's the most dirty?
So, is anybody here into sports?
Yes, hardcore.
Yeah. Football, hardcore. Huge. Football. And baseball. What's Giants the, just won. I'm a Giants. San Francisco Giants. San Francisco Niners, too. 49ers, and that's it. That's my
hardcore Raider. Us three are hardcore Raider fans over here.
Well, these two are pretty hardcore, but Mark kind of laughs at the whole thing. He's a Raider fan, but he's not overboard on it.
I doubt.
We're all pretty overboard, you know.
Gotcha. So, is there any last thing you'd like to say to the fans as a band, you know, for the future of Forbidden?
Yeah, give it a chance, man. This is you know, one thing I have learned over this whole process is this whole thing is an honor. That anyone gives a crap about us again. 100%. It is a complete gift that anyone even cared in the first place about the band, and it's another gift that they're giving us a chance to do it again. So we're giving it our best. We gave you the best record we could have possibly given you. We had every ounce of everything we had was put into that album, and I think you'll hear it when you hear it. You know, you'll feel that.
Cool, man. Well, I appreciate you guys hanging out with me. And if you want to catch up with Forbidden, you can catch them on tour right now. And, well, this might be out a little bit later.
Right now!
But you can also find their their record and any albums, I should say CD. There's not really any records anymore.
Omega Wave, most importantly. You can find the other ones. You can go backwards and get those. But you can find Omega Wave on it. You can go to Amazon. You can go to every major chain has them. You can get it on the Nuclear Blast website. You can get it through iTunes. You know, you can do whatever you want, but it's pretty much everywhere if you look for it. If you just want it to be at your front door, it's not going to be there if you don't order it.
And if you haven't checked out the band before, if you have not, Omega Wave is a great way to get into the band.
Yeah, really. That's true. We've been told that.
So, you know, it encompasses, I think, everything. So. Once you discover Omega Wave, I think if you haven't discovered Forbidden, you will go back and discover Forbidden, for sure.
And where's the best spot for them to, like, maybe chat with you guys, leave a message, talk to you on Facebook?
The Facebook page is, like, the most open, because it's just the way it is. It's inherently, like, open, you know, everyone talks. So there's always a good thing like that. That's probably what it's best for, and worst for.
MySpace/Forbidden?
Yeah, Forbidden, is it not Forbidden Official? No, it's just Forbidden.
No. MySpace.com/ForbiddenOfficial.
Official. Okay. Oh, for MySpace. Sorry, I was still thinking Facebook. No, I was waiting. I don't go back to that MySpace.
I think you're
Facebook. Facebook is.
Go to Craig's personal. He takes everybody.
His phone number is.
Don't bother.
Area code.
That's a big joke.
Yes, because I most certainly don't.
Yeah, he's at area code 666.
999. That's right. Anyhow, right. Anywho.
Once again, thanks for watching BrutalBroadcast.com. This is Death Metal Dwarf Dave. Yeah.
In your face!
The crest of the wave is crushing humankind. Rolling with ungodly force, omnipotent Omega. Delivering the pain, condemning one and all. Stricken, everyone must die.
guys for signing this guitar. It's fucking awesome. And thank you for contributing to Metal for the Military.
It's very, very cool, great, man. And I can say that Dean make beautiful guitars. I'm a Dean guy myself, and I have one of these. And I'm glad that this guitar is going for the right cause and the right people. And that's awesome.
Hell yeah, man. Appreciate it. I really do, man.
Regardless of what you think about what the situation is, the people that stand behind that,
that's right.
That's what you need to support.
That's right.